So good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here this evening, and somewhat remarkable, I think, too. I still find it astonishing, really, the change that's occurred over the last decade or so in the public appreciation of mindfulness. Indeed, knowing that the word exists as a thing. 15 years ago, when I started meditating, it was something that was considered to be mostly alternative. Perhaps if you meditated, you might be a bit new age. It was something that had the kind of hippie association with it. You might burn incense in your bedroom. All of those kind of cliches now, we might call them, about meditation practice. And we're now in this world where MPs and members of the House of Lords are meditating. In schools, students are taught meditation. In many business settings, perhaps some unlikely settings, mindfulness courses are taught. And of course, there's kind of barely a day goes by when mindfulness is not mentioned somewhere or other in the media. So there's been a huge turnaround. And I remember a couple of years ago when I was going into the Houses of Parliament. I've been involved in that work to bring mindfulness into public policy with the Mindfulness Initiative and the All-Party Parliamentary Group. And it was actually the launch date of the All-Party Parliamentary Group. And I was going into the House of Commons, and you know, this was pretty remarkable to me in itself. Like, I was going into the House of Commons. I'm a former editor of FHM. I'm now a mindfulness teacher. You know, two kind of professions which probably would not have generally got an invite into the House of Commons up until this point. And I had my bells with me, I took them through security, and the police officers there said, "I'm really sorry, you can't take those in here." And I was like, "What's?" Why can't? And apparently, the possibility was that I might use them as a weapon. I kind of throw them from the gallery, perhaps. And kind of, there was a little voice inside me which, here we go again. Yeah, it's, this is, okay, I might be coming in and maybe the MPs and the politicians might be interested, but this is still something that's kind of, not part of the mainstream. And then one of the officers turned to me and said, what are you actually here for? And I explained that this was the launch of the All-Party Parliamentary Group. And she said to me, "We could really use that." And her colleague also said, "Yeah, have you got a card that we could take and show it to our boss?" And it really struck me then that mindfulness connects with the heart when there is an opportunity for it to do so. And in fact, the reasons perhaps why mindfulness has come into the mainstream, I think they're twofold. I think one is the remarkable scientific evidence base which has developed over the last 20 years. You know, we now know that mindfulness is beneficial for reducing stress, for our sense of flourishing. It's good for maintaining attention. It's good for our relationships. It helps us self-regulate, and so on and so on and so. There are now about 4,000 peer-reviewed published studies in the scientific journals attesting to the benefits of mindfulness. So that's one reason. But I think also there's a sense perhaps of a need, a kind of heart's longing, if you like, for mindfulness. Linda Stone in the States has come up with this wonderful phrase to describe our society. She calls it an age of continuous partial attention. And I think that really sums it up for me. You know, that pull that's there from all directions to take our attention away. Indeed, some people are even talking about the attention economy. You know, how everybody wants your attention, and there's only so much of it. And so we are pulled from pillar to post. We're pulled all over the place. And we try to deal with this by multitasking, you know, by trying to do more things more quickly. And actually, our minds and brains aren't set up for that. And actually, that makes us more stressed and more ineffective. So I think there's a sense that the world that we live in, is not one that is conducive to presence, and perhaps not one that is conducive to happiness. Blaise Pascal in the 18th century, the French philosopher and mathematician, it might have been the 17th century, I can't remember, but he said, most of humanity's problems would be solved if people could learn to sit quietly in a room. And yet, we don't, on the whole. There's another one of the studies that I really like that's come up in the last couple of years was led by Timothy Wilson at the University of Virginia. Some of you may have heard of this. He got a group of people of all different ages and professions and so on, and he invited them to sit quietly in a room for 15 minutes. And he told them that this was going to be the object of the experiment. And he also, before going into the room, he gave them an electric shock. Yeah, so he kind of tied whatever it was to their ankles and gave them a painful electric shock. And he said to them, while you're in the room, you have the opportunity to give yourself another electric shock, yeah, if you fancy it. And of course, everyone went, no, I'm certainly not going to do that. In fact, he said, would you be prepared to pay me not to have another electric shock? Yes, people would be prepared to pay $5 not to be given another one of these painful electric shocks. And you can guess what happened, yeah? So they're invited to sit on their own with just their own thoughts for entertainment for 15 minutes. 50% of people gave themselves an electric shock during that time. There was one guy who pressed the buzzer 190 times, can you believe? So it just goes to show that you know, we have this sense of need, perhaps, of heart's longing, of desire for quiet, for peace. And yet the reality, when we are invited to be still, is that we notice that perhaps it's unpleasant sometimes. It's not the kind of idyll of peace and quiet that we wanted, at least not internally. And then we react to this unpleasant situation by actually creating more pain for ourselves. The electric shock study is a perfect example of that. So we notice an unpleasant experience and then we actually make it more unpleasant for ourselves. So this is perhaps where, while I think it's a wonderful thing that mindfulness has permeated into the mainstream, I think there is still an image problem, except this time the image is actually that mindfulness practice is going to bring you to a state of tranquility, necessarily, you know, perhaps very quickly, or at least in 8 weeks. Yeah. So it's and that wasn't my experience, and I think it's a lot of people's experience that actually meditation can be difficult. It's challenging just to be ourselves. Maybe somehow that's a strange thing, but it's true. And perhaps there's also this kind of myth of meditation that then gets kind of perpetuated. You know when you see the studies in the newspapers when somebody's saying something positive about meditation, you know, reduces stress or, you know, whatever the latest kind of news is. And almost invariably, the picture in the paper is of a beautiful young woman in sort of, you know, the latest yoga gear. She's either kind of on a mountain somewhere, or sometimes it's a kind of a, you know, above a swimming pool on sort of diving board, or in a, you know, there's a sort of a shining light behind her. You've seen the kind of pictures? They're the ones that are always chosen. And I think it's really unhelpful because it implies that if you meditate, that's what's going to happen. Quickly, probably. And it's not generally the case. I do believe that mindfulness practice is transformative. But my experience, at least, is that it comes from a new way of working, or a different, maybe not new, a different way of working with our experience, which actually means letting go of the expectation that happiness is going to come. I'm really well aware of, you know, being on stage here with Action for Happiness, and kind of my sort of, at least my message in some sense is that actually we need to let go of happiness and to let go of action, which leaves the four, I guess. But sorry, Mark. But But there's something deeper than this, that actually if we can perhaps drop into a different mode, into what mindfulness, those of us in the mindfulness world sometimes call the being mode, drop down from the doing mode that's always struggling and striving and trying to get and trying to get away from what's unpleasant, then actually happiness can arise. But it comes from our not trying in some sense, which doesn't mean that we don't act, we don't take action in our lives, but that the manner that we struggle perhaps for happiness, you know, struggle is not peace. So struggling for peace is kind of a, doesn't work. I've got a poem I'd like you to read, which I think speaks to this well. It's by Dorothy Hunt. Do you think peace requires an end to war? Or tigers eating only vegetables? Does peace require an absence from your boss, your spouse, yourself? Do you think peace will come some other place than here, some other time than now, in some other heart than yours? Peace is this moment without judgment, this moment in the heart space where everything that is welcome. Peace is this moment without thinking that it should be some other way, that you should feel some other thing, that your life should unfold according to your plans. Peace is the moment without judgment, this moment in the heart space where everything that is welcome. So I wonder if we might look at mindfulness in a slightly different way, perhaps not as a means to happiness so much as a means to competence, as training ourselves in the capacity to learn to live with skill, to learn to be with our experience and to make good choices based on what we find rather than what we would like to be there. Mark was just saying to me before we began that some people have been saying to him this week, I don't want to be mindful with what's going on in the world at the moment. And it's a really good example of how, well, what's happening is what's happening. The question is, how can we meet it with skill so that we can perhaps influence events in the world in perhaps our small ways, in ways that might lead to happiness. But if we're just saying the world is not how I want it to be, then we've already moved away from what is. Everything that is welcome. That's pretty challenging when you think about some of the things that are going on in the world today. Mark mentioned at the beginning my murky past. My life in my 20s, beforehand, was very much based on striving, very much based on seeking pleasure, very much based on trying to get away from anything that was difficult and an incapacity to stay with anything that was not how I wanted it to be. I wasn't aware that this way of living life was making me a lot more stressed than I might have been. I'd already experienced several episodes of depression by the time I reached my mid-20s. And yet I thought to myself, well, I've got the kind of life that surely everybody, you know, everybody my age, especially a young man in the 1990s in his 20s, would want. And yet I was unhappy. And more than that, the way that I related with that unhappiness was to struggle to change, struggle to find. Even when I decided that the life that I was living wasn't the life that I wanted, I put so much energy into trying to change that I remained unhappy. I remained in a state of struggle. And it was only actually when I discovered meditation that I realized that there was perhaps another way that wasn't dependent so much on what I did, but the manner in which I met my experience, which is what meditation began to teach me. So I'd like to just read you a short extract from the book, from Into Heart, the Heart of Mindfulness. And this is describing some of my early experiences with meditation. Stomach somersaulting, shoulders locked, fingers quivering, teeth clenched tight, pangs of panic gripping the chest, heart pulsing fast and hard, anger like a scream bellowing out from the midriff, a shield of hard depression encasing the skin, walling off the body from the outside world, thoughts circling round and round, the same ruminations over and over. Why am I stuck like this? Is it ever going to end? Why can't I be more like other people? Why can't I cope? What's wrong with me? This is never going to work. I am never going to get better. It's useless. Useless. I'm learning to meditate. Perched atop a square hard cushion in the corner of my bedroom, trying to pay attention to the movement of my breath, and this is what I'm noticing. It's the same kind of anguish that's accompanied every waking hour for the past 2.5 years. The fear, the rage, the helplessness. But there's a subtle and crucial difference now. I'm beginning to observe these patterns of thought and feeling from a different place, from somewhere I didn't previously know existed. Rather than feeling caught up entirely in the mental noise, the exhaustion, the tension, I'm beginning to watch what's happening. Perhaps not yet with equanimity, as is meant to be possible with practice, but at least without feeling that my life is nothing but pain. A sliver of space is opening up between me and the tormenting thoughts and sensations that are surging through me. This is interesting. I've been practicing for a couple of months now, daily doses of 5 or 10 minutes, as agreed with my meditation teacher. Initially, even this seemed too much. The invitation to experience just a little stillness and its implied tolerance of anxiety was too overwhelming, so we started with mindful tea drinking. My challenge was to drink one cup a day, paying attention to all the sensations of taste, touch, and smell, and returning to these whenever I noticed my mind descending into tangles of thought as it desperately tried to crack the problem of what is happening to me and why. Every other approach that I tried has seemed to be about someone offering a fix or about learning how to repair myself. Here, the view was that nothing was really wrong, so there was no problem to be sorted out. At worst, I was merely confused about how to live well. And the first step out of that confusion was to realize how it functioned through the practice of mindfulness. So, what I began to realize as I came back again and again to initially to the cup of tea, then to my breath, and then more widely to other aspects of my experience in meditation, was that it was possible to have a different relationship to difficulty that didn't actually require the difficulty to go away. That actually some degree of peace was possible in the midst of challenge, in the midst of depression even, in the midst of anxiety. And this was it was only just a very small kernel of something at the beginning, but just that possibility was not something that I'd ever been witness to previously. And it was enough. It was enough to maintain my intention and my attention to the practice. And I spent the next few years investigating this practice. And in those days, there weren't, 8-week mindfulness courses or indeed any real kind of mainstream or secular approaches to mindfulness. So like most people who are drawn to meditation, I went to my local Buddhist center. And what I learned there was very, very useful. And I particularly learned about some of the Buddhist teachings. Particularly, some of you might be familiar with the two arrows, the recognition that there's a kind of a first arrow of suffering that hits us in life that's inevitable, being born, getting older, all of the automatic thoughts and sensations that come up that are unpleasant in life. But that it's actually the second arrow that we fire at ourselves in trying to get rid of those unpleasant experiences, to make them go away, that we can't actually manage, that actually exacerbates our suffering, and that this is workable. And there is a way of practicing managing life in a way that can relieve the stress of continually firing second arrows at ourselves. So this is what I devoted myself to. I went to live at a Buddhist center for a year or so. And over that time, I spent most of the year actually in tears. I was no longer depressed. So it was kind of like a melting in some way. And so although I was crying with an openness that I'd not experienced before. Like my crying when I was depressed, and I did a lot of crying when I was depressed, was a kind of a strangled crying, a scream more like. And this what came over me during that year of just practicing more deeply was a kind of a, yeah, I can only describe it as a kind of a melting. But it still wasn't the kind of idea of mindfulness that perhaps we have, you know, of sitting on a mountain still and in rapture. But there were moments like that. So along with the melting came more and more moments of peace. So I began to realize that maybe this wasn't a quick fix. I still experienced anxiety. I still experienced plenty of low mood. But looking back over those few years already of practice, there was a shift, something beginning to change, and an opening up to the marvels of the world that previously I didn't have time for because I was too busy. I was either too busy trying to get places in the world, or I was too busy looking inwards at what was going on inside of me in a kind of ruminative way. So after about a year, I came back to the UK. I decided that it wasn't really my calling to become a Buddhist monk or to live in a Buddhist retreat center for the rest of my life. It struck me that there weren't really many jobs available for meditators at this point, just like 10 years ago. And I knew that I couldn't go back to being a journalist full-time. And so I was very fortunate to have some connections at the Mental Health Foundation, where I'd worked before going away to France. And I started working with them again. At least there was some sense of connection there, of wanting to work for well-being. And I came across, while I was there, Jon Kabat-Zinn's work. And I saw in his approach to mindfulness, he called it mindfulness rather than meditation. Meditation still had these connotations, you know, the hippie kind of new age and so on. In his approach to mindfulness, I saw a way that the messages and the invitations and the experiences that I had found following a Buddhist path might be more available to people who weren't interested in that particular tradition. And not only that, but that research had been done on it. I knew from my work with the Mental Health Foundation that research was very important, and that Kabat-Zinn had worked with Mark Williams and his colleagues here in the UK and in Zindel Siegel in Canada, and that their work had shown that mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, which is a fairly new treatment or approach at that point, had the effect over 12 months of reducing depression in people who are prone to it by 40 to 50%. So it was very simple and direct. And yet it maintained the core, the heart of what I had learned through Buddhist training. And the simplicity of the approach, just looking at this like exercise for the mind. Yeah, you train your body with physical exercise, and so we can train the mind with with mindfulness. And I was just very aware when I was growing up that, you know, there was no manual for the mind. You know, it wasn't like you could look and people would tell you. You know, there weren't things like Action for Happiness. So I, and I think many other people, we just kind of went wherever our minds took us. And yet, here was a mainstream approach to teaching people how to manage their minds. So how about we try a practice at this point? See what this is like. So I'm aware there may be some people here who are very experienced meditators, and there may be people here who never practiced meditation before. So inviting beginner's mind, as it's sometimes known. This is the first and only time that you will practice this just now. And so taking a posture that feels dignified for you, whatever that is, if you... just tuning in to your mind and body, noticing places of contact, perhaps feet on the ground, bottom on the chair. Noticing sensations through the body. What's here just now? And perhaps offering your attention to the sensations of your breathing. Gently directing attention to the flow of your breath that's already happening within you, so not having to manipulate the breath in the way, just in any way, just letting it be as it is, and just dropping your attention into the breath and letting it follow the breath moment by moment. And when you notice that your mind has wandered away from the breath, congratulating yourself for noticing, and just gently dropping back into the breath. And inviting you to notice what in your experience right now is pleasant. It's just mentally scanning the body and just noticing what's pleasant, if anything. What's the quality of the experiences that you're noticing? What do they feel like? Rising or falling in intensity? Noticing any changes in location? Noticing any thoughts about pleasant experience or lack of it. Now shifting your attention to notice any unpleasant experience or experiences. Are there any places in the body where what's here is uncomfortable? It might be a restlessness or pain, or tension. It's bringing awareness to these experiences as they arise, if they arise. And if there's none, then noticing the absence. And any reactions that are coming up to unpleasant experience, maybe thoughts of, I wish this would go away, or hope this ends soon, this meditation. It's inviting you to be interested in the experience of unpleasant in this moment. And perhaps with an out-breath, just letting go of the unpleasant and inviting you to open your eyes and to turn to someone who's nearby you, perhaps the person that you were speaking to at the start of the evening, and just to describe for one another for a couple of minutes, what was your experience of pleasant and or unpleasant in that meditation practice? So maybe we could just take a straw poll. I'd be interested to hear. Putting your hand up, if you will, if your experience was more pleasant than unpleasant in that practice. Uh-huh. And for who was the experience more unpleasant than pleasant in that practice? Okay, so that's about 50-50. Yeah, so... Jack Cornfield sometimes talks about the 10,000 joys and the 10,000 sorrows of life. We've got about an even balance here. Yeah. And so when we find ourselves struggling to get more of the pleasant and trying to get away from the unpleasant, we're actually shifting the balance towards the unpleasant because we're creating struggle. So what I discovered in meditation practice was that if I could offer that same sense of equanimity to the pleasant and the unpleasant, just to notice it, then that already changed my experience. So I think there are a few elements of mindfulness that I'd just like to draw attention to. So what are we actually doing when we meditate? Well, first of all, we are directing attention. And the Western mind is sometimes characterized as being lost in thought. Yeah, we are by habit distracted. According to a study done by Matt Killingsworth at Harvard, we're actually not paying attention to what we're doing 47% of the time. And interestingly, we're less happy when our minds are wandering than when we're present to what we're doing, even if what we're doing is something unpleasant. So interestingly, by coming back, we're actually letting go of the negativity bias that actually makes our experience more glass half empty than glass half full. In fact, it's been shown that with John Gottman's work that in a relationship, five times as many pleasant experiences are required to maintain a relationship as unpleasant experiences. That's the kind of balance that's needed to sustain balance. Yeah, and it just shows kind of how if you know that experience where you have a good day, yeah, you have a really good day, and so one person says one unpleasant thing to you. At the end of the day, that's the one that you remember, isn't it? That's the one that we ruminate over. So it just shows that negativity bias when the mind wanders. We become very self-critical. and we become entangled in our thoughts. There's a famous phrase that's often attributed to Mark Twain, who never actually said it. It's in a novel that comes from a writer called Thomas Dixon, where there's a character who says, "I'm an old man now, and I've had many troubles, most of which never happened." And yet, that's kind of how we're always thinking about what's going to go wrong, what has gone wrong. Yeah, and this makes sense. It's, you know, from an evolutionary point of view, we need to be alert to threats. Yeah, if we miss a pleasant experience, then no problem, there'll be another one along tomorrow. But if we miss a threat, then that might be the end for us in evolutionary terms. So this makes sense that the mind wanders into the unpleasant. But of course, while it's good for survival, it's not particularly good for happiness. So learning to attend to our experience just as it is a way of freeing ourselves from that that negativity bias. So that's one thing that's happening when we practice mindfulness. But there's something more, which is that there's a sense of approach too. So we're not just attending, but we're attending or we're invited to attend in a fully present and non-reactive way, with kindness indeed. So the invitation is to stay with difficult experiences. As Rumi said, don't turn your head. Keep looking at the bandage place. That's where the light enters. Keep looking at the bandage place. So the invitation to stay with what's difficult in order to see the light that's already there. And when we stay with difficult experiences, we're actually training ourselves in resilience, in steadfastness. We're invited to let go of struggling. And we're invited to bring a sense of curiosity and kindness to our experience. What's really going on here? And what the studies have shown, Norman Farb, who's one of the foremost neuroscientists of mindfulness, he's shown that meditators feel just as much emotion as people who don't meditate, but they don't get so stuck on the stories about what's happening. The rumination process begins to be dropped. So it's not like, you know, sometimes there's an idea that when you meditate, you become kind of divorced from feeling. Now, my experience is quite the contrary. Actually, I discovered much, much more feeling when I began to meditate, and not all pleasant. But what I also discovered is that there was a possibility of uncoupling my thoughts about what was happening from the actual experience itself. First arrow, second arrow. Noticing also that we're invited to come back to the body, to our embodiment. You know, in Buddhist psychology, there are six senses, the five that we usually think of, and thinking, mental events. And yet, do we give 1/6 of our time to each of those? We spend a lot of time up in the head, or at least I do. So maybe that balance, it can be redressed. We can actually drop down into the senses, to embodiment. It's a famous line in one of James Joyce's books, The Dubliners, where he says, talks about a character called Mr. Duffy. Mr. Duffy lived a few feet from his body. Again, that's kind of that up into the head. So we're invited to come down, to stay present to what's here. So to attend, yes, but to attend in a particular way. But there's more still. Because when we notice what's happening in our experience, the pleasant and the unpleasant, then we're actually discovering awareness. And remembering that in John Kabat-Zinn's definition of mindfulness, it's the awareness that arises from paying attention in a particular way. The awareness that arises. And as soon as we know what's happening as it's happening, we've got the possibility of learning from it. That's what mindfulness is. So whatever comes up, the pleasant, the unpleasant, the neutral, if we're able to pay attention in this embodied way, then that's mindfulness. Whatever is coming up. There's a lovely phrase from that comes from St. Francis of Assisi. It's really struck me when I read it. He said, "The one you're looking for is the one who's looking. The one you're looking for is the one who's looking." When we actually recognize that there's a witness to our experience, that we can see, then that changes everything. There's a whole world of difference between the thought, I'm stupid, might come up in our minds, and noticing the thought, I'm stupid. I'm stupid, noticing the thought that I'm stupid, changes the relationship with our experience. Suddenly, seeing mind wandering when we're meditating is a success, not a distraction. Oh, I've noticed, brilliant. And yet so often we can buy into the myth of meditation where somehow we're supposed to maintain a completely still mind on whatever it is that we're attending to, or even kind of more commonly a blank mind, an empty mind. Yeah, actually, the seeing of the wandering is already mindfulness. So this is the being mode that mindfulness teachers sometimes talk about. Actually being able to notice and be aware of what's coming up, whatever it is. You know, if you throw a stick for a dog, what happens? Yeah, runs after it, doesn't he? What happens if you throw a stick for a lion? Anyone tried it? Me neither. If you throw a stick, I'm told this is true. If you throw a stick for a lion, first thing that happens is it goes, who threw that? Yeah, and that's the shift that we're making. Yeah, most of the time we're just kind of scampering after our experience like dogs. As soon as we stop and we're still, we look, we're becoming more like the lion. Actually seeing, what's really going on here? Where's all this coming from? And I think can be interesting if we are willing to make that that turn to look, because we discover something interesting. And this is something that perhaps isn't always taught on. It's not something that comes up a lot when you read about mindfulness. Sometimes it doesn't come up, although it's implied in a mainstream mindfulness course, which is that when we look, we start to see that we're not quite the selves that we thought we were. Because if I'm not my thoughts because I can see my thoughts, and if I'm not my emotions because I can see my emotions, and I'm not my reactions because I can see them, then I'm not caught in the self that I thought I was. There's something else that can actually see what's going on, and we start to see that there's actually more of a flow of experience. I can look back and see, well, hang on a minute, I'm not the same me that I was when I was 2 years old. I'm not the same me that I was when I was 35 years old. Actually, the scientists tell us that, you know, the skin is rejuvenating every 6 weeks. The liver regenerates once every year. The skeleton every 10 years. So quite literally, quite physically, we are not the same selves today as we were however long ago. We're continually changing. And things are continually changing. So when we actually look with awareness, we start to discover that actually what seemed to be fixed and solid, me, is much, much more fluid than we perhaps thought. But we can sense it when we pay attention. We're also affected by others. You know, we're permeable. The research by Fowler and Christakis found that if one of your friends is happy, you're actually 15% likely to be happier yourself. Ditto if one of your friends is overweight, you're 15% more likely to become overweight yourself. Yeah, and this goes for all sorts of different kind of habit behaviors and situations. So we are affected by what's going on around us. And it's more like actually experience is a bit more, it's a bit more like a river. Yeah, things are flowing. And we start to see this when we practice meditation. And you may say, well, why is this important? Why have we sort of gone from staying present to noticing the flow of experience? Well, I'd like to suggest that moving into the heart of mindfulness enables a recognition of this that is actually very empowering. First of all, we start to be able to be more able, perhaps, to accept our limitations. We can recognize that you can't actually stop a river. You know, you can't keep putting barriers in. You know, you can, but the river will overcome. So we start to be able to accept our limitations. things that we can't change. This is the acceptance, perhaps, that sometimes is mentioned as a part of mindfulness. We perhaps become friendlier to ourselves, knowing that we're not, it's not our fault that we are who we are. There's all sorts of causes and conditions that have created this experience of being me just now. But also, we can work with change and for change, because as soon as we have awareness, as soon as we're able to see what's happening and to recognize this flow, just like with a river, we can start to flow with it and we can start to influence what's happening. So it's a bit like the Serenity Prayer says, you know, accepting the things we can't change, but if we have the courage to change the things we can, recognizing the difference between the two is the key. And that's what awareness offers us. So it's not my fault that I am who I am, but I do have some responsibility from where I take myself from here. And this I found enormously empowering, particularly as someone who's had experience of depression, where all of that power feels like it's been taken away, and anxiety too. Yeah, one of my sort of main experiences in depression was one of hopelessness and helplessness, feeling like there was nothing that I could do, because that is how it felt. These days, I still have experiences that I would used to have called depression and anxiety, but I don't tend to use the word depression anymore because somehow it doesn't encapsulate the experience, because I don't feel that same sense of powerlessness. I can recognize, oh yeah, this is where this is coming from. This is how I can be with it. And I've learned ways in which I can stay with it and perhaps gently help myself through it rather than the kind of fight or flight struggle that I used to engage in when I was depressed. So there's the possibility of acceptance if we recognize that we're not fixed selves. There's the possibility of change that comes up. But more than that, there's an opening up, I would say, a recognition that actually we are in touch with the world. We can be in touch with the world. We can be in tune with what's actually going on. We can be in flow. And I think this is one of the great benefits of mindfulness practice over time, is that we start to be more retuned to the wonder of the world. It's a poem I'd like to read by Mary Oliver called The Sun. Some of you may know it. Have you ever seen anything in your life more wonderful than the way the sun, every evening, relaxed and easy, floats toward the horizon and into the clouds or the hills or the rumpled sea and is gone? And how it slides again out of the blackness every morning on the other side of the world. Like a red flower streaming upward on its heavenly oils, say, on a morning in early summer, at its perfect imperial distance. And have you ever felt for anything such wild love? Do you think there is anywhere in any language a word billowing enough for the pleasure that fills you as the sun reaches out, as it warms you, as you stand there empty-handed? Or have you too turned from this world? Or have you too gone crazy for power, for things? So connection, but also compassion. As soon as we realize that we're all connected, then the only thing, as Naomi Shihab Nye says, the only thing that makes sense anymore is kindness. Because the scientific studies are showing this, that actually offering compassion, not just to ourselves, but to those around us, this brings happiness back to us. It's what the Dalai Lama calls selfish altruism. Great phrase. The idea that actually, if we're kind to others, it comes back to us. So even if we're doing it just for ourselves, it's worth it. We feel better as a result. There's an interesting study, another one I want to mention. It was led by Paul Condon a few years ago. It's of a group of participants in a mindfulness course. And after the course, he told them that they were going to be taking part in some neuroscience research, going to have their kind of, you know, brains measured, EEGs, that kind of thing. But actually, the real experiment took place in the waiting room. And in the waiting room, there were some stooges. So one was an actress, and she came into the room, apparently with a broken leg, on crutches, went up against the wall, and sighed. And there were several other people in the room who were sitting on seats, who didn't give up their seat. And these were all the stooges. And what they were actually testing was whether the person who was coming in for their supposed brain scan would give up their seat, even though everybody else wasn't. And curiously, what they found is that the people who'd taken the mindfulness course were three times as likely to give up their seat as those in the control group who hadn't yet gone through the mindfulness training. I find that fascinating, because a mindfulness course doesn't explicitly train us in compassion for others. So it seems to be, this is what this suggests, it seems to be that simply tuning to ourselves in a friendly way, changing our relationship to who we are, which is what's offered in mindfulness practice, without any direction, affects how we relate with others. Actually changes our relationship in the way towards kindness. So sometimes, you know, along with the myths of mindfulness being kind of all, you know, peace and light and happiness and so on, one of the other myths that can come up is that it's a kind of a selfish thing to do. It's like, you know, have you seen the state the world's in and you're meditating? Sitting on your, you know, doing nothing? That can come up sometimes. Well, actually, maybe this is the way to create in ourselves the compassion that can then lead us into action, the kind of action that might be helpful rather than perhaps the knee-jerk impulsive reaction that we might be automatically drawn to, at least speaking for myself. So meditation training, mindfulness training, is actually a moving from me to we, even though it's not perhaps dressed up as such. Another thing Jack Kornfield says, he says, quieting the mind is a political act. And this is why I'm so pleased to have been part of the work that's been happening in the UK Parliament, and why I'm so pleased that mindfulness training is becoming more available in schools. Why it's I'm pleased that it's happening in businesses. In fact, there's a piece of work that shows that if you train leaders, business leaders, in mindfulness, the people who work for them, their well-being improves, even if the word mindfulness is never mentioned to them. So it has this ripple effect, because we're not separate, because we're not fixed, because we are in connection with others. So there's a kind of a ripple effect of mindfulness practice that naturally flows out once we begin training. Wise action seems to happen as a result of the training. I mean, I certainly didn't have any, you know, great idea of going from being deputy editor of FHM to becoming a mindfulness teacher and some great, you know, plan to, you know, do good in the world and, you know, that, just, you know, I wanted to be happy. And I am. I certainly am. My life is very, very different from how it was then. You know, I have a wonderful family. I never thought that I would actually be able to hold down a relationship, have children. Kind of, that just wasn't something that I could even conceive of 15 years ago. And yet these things have come slowly through mindfulness practice, you know, through kind of, you know, my own desire to be happy. And yet now most of the work that I do is working with other people, which brings great joy, to me at least. But it's not easy. sometimes I've heard the word used for the sort of mindfulness craze, if you like, sort of muck mindfulness. Yeah, it's sort of this mindfulness light. You know, somehow it's not the real deal. Well, it does take work. And it's not necessarily the real deal, the way that it's presented in the media. It's a skill, and like any other skill, if you want to become good at it, you have to practice and keep practicing. And that way it's a bit like, you know, exercise, physical exercise. You know, if you stop, you just do a little bit, you just get a little bit of result. Of course, the difficulty with meditation is we also have to give up trying to get to the result. And just, if we can, just do it for its own sake. But the good news is that we already have all that we need to do this. We've all got bodies. We've all got minds. So actually, the struggling to get to be somebody who we're not isn't so necessary, perhaps. It's already here. The difficulty or the challenge is our capacity to tune into it. Remembering our capacity to tune into it. Remembering. So I'm going to finish there on that good news, and it is good news. I'm aware that I've kind of started with what may seem like lots of bad news. You know, mindfulness not easy and so on, but transformation is possible if we give ourselves to it. And I'd like to finish just by asking you to just pair up once again and inviting you to make an intention. What one choice could you make now to take you deeper into mindfulness? And this could be an action, could be something that you choose to do, or it could be a non-action, it could be a stepping back. Or maybe it's an attitudinal shift, a sense of a non-striving or a letting go or practicing more gentleness, gratitude, curiosity. It might be a recognition, just a willingness to see what's actually here right now in me. The courage to look at what's here. Or it might even just be a decision to get interested. What's actually going on in here? And out there, but maybe in here first. So I'll leave it to you to decide, and we'll just maybe have a couple of minutes for this, and then I will hand back over to Mark. So what one choice could you make now? It goes for something small, yeah? Not like I'm going to change the world next week. Just something, a small shift that you could make yourself to bring mindfulness more deeply into your life.
Very sorry to interrupt what was obviously some really, really engaging, interesting conversations there. I certainly enjoyed the conversation Tracy and I were having. Before doing anything else, and before opening up for questions, and there's something else we got as a surprise as well a bit later on, I'd love to invite you to join me in thanking Ed for his wonderful talk, first of all. I'm sure you've got lots of interesting questions, and we're going to have some time between now and 1:30 to take those. And Ed's kindly agreed to stay around and speak to people afterwards and potentially sign some copies of his book if you're interested in having one of those. Merge. So we've got one here we'll start with, and then I can see a hand towards the back, Alex, as well, so we'll take that one next. Over to you.
Thank you, Ed. That was a stunning presentation. Thank you very much. I wanted to ask my standpoint is I talk about emotional intelligence, and I wanted to link the two arrows and the second arrow, which is where we actually can shoot ourselves, and tie it up with a question, and I'm not an expert in this, but my understanding is the conscious mind can only think of 5 thoughts at any one time, and whatever we focus on expands or strengthens. So I take that as true, so experts can argue with me. Taking that as true, acknowledging an honest thought is very healthy. I've been through my own journey there. How do we then navigate the danger of that realization and acceptance becoming our second arrow?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a great question. And for me, there is a difference between recognition and acknowledgement and rumination. And so there's a when I'm acknowledging and recognizing a thought, it's there, but I'm not giving energy to it in the sense that I'm not identified with that thought. Yeah, so I used the example in the talk of the thought, I'm stupid. Yeah, and that you can feel the energy perhaps that we might give to that. You know, I am stupid. Yeah, there's emotional energy going into it. And then noticing the thought that I'm stupid. You know, and the tone that we can give to that, that actually doesn't have that same drawing down into, you know, the kind of emotional pit that might come with it. So it's a kind of an untangling of the recognition from the kind of the emotional reaction. And so that emotional reaction is the second arrow. Now, once we've acknowledged, then there are lots of possible choices that we could make. You know, so having freed ourselves from the automatic being, you know, kind of sucking into the quicksand, you know, if we're able to notice that and notice the pull towards that, then we've got the choice. We could just stay and notice, or we might choose to cultivate, yeah, and perhaps decide, okay, actually, I'm going to choose to go and talk to a friend. Ask them, do you think I'm stupid? No, of course you're not. And then we, you know, so we start to kind of feed into ourselves perhaps more nurturing thoughts and connections. So, but the starting point is the acknowledgement, I would suggest, because what we want to do is we want, you know, at least again, I'll speak for myself, so desperately to get away from that unpleasant thought, yeah, and the quicksand it can bring us into, that there can be a kind of a, don't want to go there. And then there's a sort of tense getting away from, got to run away from this thought that I'm stupid, you know, maybe, or you know, suppress it. Whereas somehow, if we can just acknowledge, oh yeah, you're there, I know you, I can actually even be kind to you as a thought that's coming up. I'm not going to believe you, but I can see that you're here. And then from that point, rather than being a kind of a sort of tightness, there's actually then some room to maneuver. So that would be my kind of understanding of the difference between, you know, kind of a thought being noticed and a thought being thunk, if you like. I don't know if that's helpful at all.
Yeah. Any answer that has the word thunk in it.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever used the word thunk before. certainly not on stage.
Thank you for the question and for that answer. And there was another one over here, I think. So over to you.
Hello. Hi.
Sorry, I don't know. Who am I speaking
Hello?
To?
Hello. Oh, over here.
Hi.
you said the serenity prayer, and I was interested in when you said about how mindfulness can help you to have some more wisdom when it comes to knowing when to make a change and when not to make a change. And I wondered if you could say a little bit more about how it can help you to make decisions when something is giving you grief or whatever, and knowing whether to make a change with it or whether to kind of mindfully accept it.
Yeah, I can, but I'm not sure that my answer is going to be satisfactory. What I've noticed is that if I can tune into all of me rather than just up here, which is where the negativity bias happens and the kind of the fixation happens and the black and white thinking and the catastrophizing and all of the rest, all of those biases that we have. when I can recognize that there's another place that I can experience from, I actually tune into the body sensations of what's going on, into my gut. And then also that there's kind of something in the middle here too. So there's the heart. And then I've got head, heart, and gut, and the whole body indeed, to take in. Then somehow I find I can contact something wiser, maybe, that seems to work. I mean, because I can't pretend to say I know how this, really how this happens. But it seems to, if I can pause and stop and tune into all of what's here, then more skillful decisions seem to happen. And I suspect it's because, it brings me out of that fight-flight mode, which is useful in some circumstances. Yeah, so sometimes we need to be reacting automatically. Yeah, but it's not not good in the situations where we don't have a car coming at us, and we need to be getting out of the way, or we're about to put our hand in the fire. Then fight or flight is brilliant. Yeah, but when it's an emotional experience or a difficult decision that we just want to get done right now, I found that waiting and tuning in is more helpful. Sometimes the image that's used for meditation practice is a bit like riding a horse. Yeah, and sort of loosely speaking, the kind of horse is our bodies, and the rider is our kind of cognitive mind. And actually, if you want to ride effectively through the environment, you need both. Yeah, but if you're just trying to horse ride without a horse, or you just let the horse do whatever it wants, you're probably not going to get to where you're intending to go. So it's something about bringing into union these parts of ourselves that have become separated, or that do become easily separated again and again, and then somehow the flow seems to happen more. But I can't promise that's. I can describe it, but it's something about the practice over time that enables that to happen more and more. And then it doesn't. Plenty of unwise decisions get made, I can assure you. Yeah, but maybe more so, there's a possibility of tuning in. The more we're tuned in to what's going on, aren't we more likely to be able to relate with what's happening more effectively?
Ed, one of the contexts that question often comes up in is in connection with, if we're being mindful and thinking about our own experience, do we sort of shut ourselves off from some of the big world issues that we could and should be acting on as active citizens and so on? And what I loved about what you said about the sort of natural kindness and natural connection and awareness is that sort of recognition that in fact we do have this influence on the world around us by being more tuned in and being wiser as individuals, that they can have that sort of wider societal impact. So thank you for reminding us of that. Okay, can we see another show of hands for questions while we've still got time available? So there's one in the front row we'll come to next, and then two ladies over here in the middle section we'll come to next, Alex. Thank you. All yours.
Hi.
Hello.
Thank you for your talk. It just occurred to me as you were talking, as somebody that's also been a meditator for, I can't remember now, maybe 15 years, that what you're describing is, to me, coming into right relationship with one's body. And that right relationship is something that certainly in the parlance of meditation circles was really missing. I'm just wondering whether it's something you're hearing more now, because I think the word mindfulness and I think the word meditation has actually got us quite locked between the heart centre and the head. Mm. And more and more, that mindfulness for me has actually really allowed me to come back into right relationship with my body and listen to the clues, which, frankly, for 15 to 20 years, I completely ignored, and they affected my health. So I was just wondering whether, it just sort of triggered a question based on what you're doing now. Are you hearing and seeing a bit more of that? And I think that's actually very important, because for me, I think it's lacking.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, it's somewhat unfortunate, isn't it, this word mindfulness, that in English, it tends to sort of already take us up here somewhere. It's something to do with mind, as this mind, and, in a lot of the Eastern languages, mind really is heart. And Jon Kabat-Zinn talks about this a lot, how about, really mindfulness is heartfulness. You know, I would say perhaps it's as much bodyfulness. You know, let's take it even further. You know, let's be our whole, you know, our whole selves. But yeah, I had this experience too, you know, when I was first meditating for a number of years, that, you know, it was still very much happening up here. Because that's, you know, that was my habit. So it was inevitable with this new practice of meditation that I was going to bias it up, you know, up here. And I think actually what's very skillful about the, you know, if you like, mainstream mindfulness approach is that a lot of attention is paid to the body. You know, I think particularly for the world that we live in, you know, that's very, very helpful, you know, just to kind of just shift that balance from, you know, automatically going up here and, you know, dropping the attention down here. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so I don't mind which of those two hands that were up goes first, but if we could pass the microphone on afterwards.
Hello.
Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me?
Hello.
Hi. Okay, so I'm relatively new to meditation, but I'm not new to mindfulness, and I'm definitely not new to things like self-care. My question is, I was actually one of the people, when we did the little practice earlier on, who put my hand up because it was more unpleasant for me. My question is, when you feel anxious when you start meditating, how do you push through those feelings? Is it something that you should push through, or is it something that you should, you know, stop, take time, and then continue at a later time? Or how do you deal with anxiety, basically, when you start meditating?
Yeah, big question. Yeah. I'm struck by the phrase that you used of pushing through. How did you work with it in the practice? What did you find happening?
I got very cynical.
You became very...
I became very, very cynical. I was like, it's not going to work.
Cynical, yeah. Okay. Yeah, so you had the thought, this isn't going to work. I'm anxious.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's not going to make any... Yeah. Yeah, and maybe it's not in the moment. And I think this is a very... This is a difficult thing. I mean, one of my patterns is anxiety. And, you know, you say that you're new to meditation, so I think first and foremost, it's really, really important to take this very gently and slowly, yeah, and to kind of to free ourselves from having to get anywhere with it, because actually that is the practice, yeah. But it's not an easy... You know, when we're experiencing unpleasant sensations and anxiety is, you know, a really unpleasant experience to kind of, you know, to hear, oh, well, you know, we can sit with our anxiety and experience it. You know, that's not an easy thing to do, you know, if we're new to the practice. So it's just like anything else, you know, if you were learning to swim, you probably wouldn't want someone to throw you in the swimming pool, you know, and say, okay, well, you know, you'll learn to swim. You know, we've got to go very, very gently with this. And, you know, I'd encourage you to find someone that you can work with to help you with that. You know, perhaps on a mindfulness course or, you know, somebody who's skilled in working gently with this. I found that it's taken me, you know, quite a long time to become friends with my anxiety. You know, I'm even now, a little bit, something just stuck at the bottom of my throat when I said that. Becoming friends with my anxiety. So I said the words, and that old reaction was still there. Kind of, I don't want to be friends with my anxiety. Mm. And yet, what I found is actually the more I'm able to practice that, the more I'm not pushing away the experience. The less scary it is. It doesn't mean that it becomes pleasant, but it becomes interesting. Or it has become interesting, but you know, it's for me that hasn't been a quick road. Like any of you know, like you know, as I've been saying, it's not a quick road. But so it's really, really important to go gently with it. But it is possible. I'm afraid you'd have to just take that on trust at the moment. I'd be really happy to talk to you more about it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I've got two questions. I realise how cheeky that is, but the first one's really, really quick, which is, could you say again the name of the guy that did the research study where the woman had the broken leg and people gave up their seats?
Yeah, Paul Condon.
Condon.
C-O-N-D-O-N. One of the Canadian universities, I think, or it might have been Columbia.
Thank you.
But, yeah, it might have been Columbia.
Okay, so the other question is a bit more interesting, which is I wanted to hear your thoughts on the apps that you can get on your phone, like Headspace and Bidify, and how you feel about them.
Yeah, well, I'm probably not really qualified because I haven't used them. I mean, I do know both of the people sort of behind both of the apps that you've mentioned, they are practitioners with experience and also, knowledge of that area that I don't have. So, I have a strong degree of trust that what they're offering has integrity. But I haven't actually, I haven't used them myself.
I think what I'm asking is it okay? Oh, that's interesting, isn't it? I think what I'm asking is, do I need to be taught to meditate by a guru, or can I just download an app?
Guru? Where are you going to find one of those? So can you learn through an app? Yeah, well, some people can. Many people report that they're very helpful. I think it depends a little bit on who we are and what our needs are and what our situation is. I mean, I kind of liken it a bit to learning the piano. It's another skill that we might cultivate. Could we learn to play the piano from a recorded voice taking us through? Probably. Yeah, probably be quite helpful. Yeah. More so than a book when we're reading it ourselves, where we're having to do this. Yeah, maybe. But a book might be helpful to learn about reading the playing the piano. The guided voice might help us through, but is it going to be the same as having a teacher there with you who you can ask questions of and who can maybe point things out to you face to face? So I think maybe it's not about is it right or wrong or good or bad, but what help are we looking for, and where do we want to go with it?
I think that that piano learning analogy is very helpful, Edna. Thank you for that. It's a great question. The only thing I'd add, having done the 8-week mindfulness course reasonably recently, and having used apps and various other things with my own, not desperately substantial mindfulness practice, but. Is the thing that also comes, as well as the wisdom of talking to a teacher and expert in a course setting, is you see other people who are struggling with the same things. When you're using an app, you don't really get that group feedback. I find it incredibly powerful to be in a room with others going, "God, I find this really hard," and hearing their experiences, "Oh, you're like me too." And I think there's something really beautiful about that communal sharing learning that you can't really get in an app, and you probably can't get it from a book either, actually.
Yeah.
So,
thank you for adding that, Mark. Yeah. That's really helpful.
So,
Why are you laughing? Community is really, having a community of people to kind of share with is I've found enormously important. Because if we're on our own, then it's very difficult to sustain a practice. This isn't an easy thing to sustain, but when you've got a group of people who are learning the same thing together, then as I say, you can learn from one another and from the difficulties that we each have.
We've got time for one last question before we show our appreciation for Ed and then roll this little video and allow you to get away. So I don't like to play the game of who's waving their hand highest, but there are some rather keen people. But I did see this hand go first, so in fairness, I'm going to go over to this, take this question here. Have I missed anyone upstairs? I appreciate that. No, okay, good.
Hi, thank you for that talk. It was very powerful. I've actually got an app called the Insight Timer, which I'd like to recommend to anybody. I do believe in apps because, of course, you need to learn how to meditate. That's a different thing. But once you've learned how to meditate, then using an app can be extremely useful, because it's, you know, meditation for me anyway, and I've been meditating for 15 years, it's not about the emotion, it's not about the feeling, it's about the practice. And it's the practice that you do day after day after day after day that builds, creates mindfulness in you, in my experience anyway. So you become almost a better person. But it can take, as you said, it's a very gentle thing. It takes a long time. But the app, for me, is like, you know, I only do 10 minutes meditation a day. But I've been doing 10 minutes a day for the last 15 years. So I haven't had the app for 15 years, but I find it really useful because I it just helps me discipline myself to do my meditation. So it wasn't really a question, it was more... You know.
So thank you for that observation. I also use the app as well, I agree. Ed, is there, and before we sort of stop and pause here, is there any final thought you'd like to leave everyone with around this theme of this evening? Any last words?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of echo that the practice itself is worthwhile, and staying with. Yeah, so it's one of the kind of saddest thing I think that I hear quite often is people who give up meditation because the experience is not what they expected it to be, and I feel, you know, I feel really, oh, because that could have been me. Fortunately, I had people around me who were able to kind of hold me through that, and so I just yeah, stay. If you think there's something in here for you, then trusting that. I'm not saying, you know, maybe it's not for everyone. That's okay. We each got to make our own choices. But perhaps listening into the heart, the wise mind, as we sometimes call it, and we all have it already. So trusting that.
What a great way to end. In a moment, we'll share this film, but please join me in sharing a lot of appreciation to Ed. Thank you.